Hello everyone, I am Be Better Gamer. Welcome to my YouTube channel, your place if you want to watch some Let's Plays for WWF No Mercy, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, and like today's episode, WCW NW Revenge. Thank you for coming to my channel. Today I will be going for the Cruiserweight Championship with one of my favorite wrestlers of all time, one of my favorite characters to play as in this game, and that is Ultimo Dragon. If this video looks familiar to you, it's because when I first started this channel, I started uploading just gameplay footage of WCW NW Revenge. So I was just doing playthroughs, no commentary, I didn't have a mic like I do now. And I was just doing, you know, playthroughs on the hard difficulty for the various championships and Revenge. Eventually I got my mic and I started doing No Mercy Let's Plays, and then I started doing Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 Let's Plays and WCW NW Revenge Let's Plays. And I've been kind of inconsistent with getting them done. I have a very busy personal life, so I've decided to, going forward for my WCW NW Revenge Let's Plays, why not take all that lovely gameplay footage that I've already recorded and let me go ahead and just add commentary on top of that. So I am taking my Ultimo Dragon gameplay footage and I'm gonna do a Let's Play of Ultimo Dragon. My last WCW NW Revenge upload was Eddie Guerrero. So basically the first championship belt that I'm gonna work through in my Let's Plays is gonna be the Cruiserweight title. I did a few other Let's Plays. I did a Macho Man Let's Play, I did a Sting Let's Play. Those were kind of little one-off Let's Plays. I wasn't really following a specific format. But much like my WWF No Mercy Let's Plays, where I'm going through all the various titles, I feel like it's no better place to start than the Cruiserweight Championship, one of my favorite divisions back in the days, WCW. I'm sure everyone loved the Cruiserweight division. I mean, the roster was stacked with legendary Cruiserweights, and Ultimo Dragon was one of them. At the time, he was about 30 years old when he came to WCW. Ultimo Dragon, his real name is Yoshihiro Asai, and that's very important because the Asai Moonsault was named after him because he innovated the Asai Moonsault. He didn't innovate the Moonsault, that's, you know, way back people were doing that. But he was the first one to do it from the ring apron to the outside, so everyone started calling it the Asai Moonsault. He made his professional wrestling debut in Japan in 1987, but he wasn't Ultimo Dragon. I believe he was probably just Yoshihiro Asai, or maybe he had another gimmick. I'm not so sure. Things weren't really working out for him in Japan, so he went over to Mexico. That's when they gave him the mask. That's when he became the Ultimo Dragon. That's when he became a hot commodity. And then he went back to Japan, started feuding with Liger, started feuding with Great Sasuke, and eventually he made his way over to WCW. He debuted at Hog Wild 96 against Rey Mysterio Jr. for the Cruiserweight title. Now, if you've ever watched my WCW NW Revenge Let's Plays or any of my Let's Plays before, basically what I like to do is I like to talk about the historical context of the game, as well as the gameplay itself. So like right now, Chavo Guerrero ran in, and that's gonna screw me up. But if you ever have a run-in, the easiest way to get rid of the characters who run in is just weak grapple them. Just weak grapple an A. Yeah, weak grapple an A doesn't do a lot of damage to wrestlers in general, but the way the interfering like AI works, I guess you can say, is that as long as they get hit with like at least 3 or 4 moves, they'll leave. And that's grapple moves. I'm not so sure about striking moves. I don't know if striking moves really get rid of them faster. But I do know if you do hit them with some grapple moves, just hit them with some weak grapples. There I hit him with a strong grapple, and look, Chavo's done. He's over it. He's like, ah, screw this noise. And we'll talk more about Chavo Guerrero and Ultimo Dragon later on, because basically what I like to do with the historical context is I like to talk about the year from which the game was being developed all the way until the game was being released. So in this case, for WCW NWO Revenge, it was released in October of 98. WCW NWO World Tour was the first AKI developed game, and that was released in November of 97. So along with a few other tidbits that I'm going to talk about with Ultimo Dragon, I'm going to focus from that time, from November of 97 to October 98, and what he was doing, what feuds he was going on, what matches went on, and I'm going to focus around the pay-per-views so that you guys could go back and watch it on the WWE Network if you have it. And, you know, they also have some early Nitros, which he was a part of, some 96 Nitros, because, again, he made his debut at Hog Wild 96. So he only stayed in WCW for about 2 years, but he made an impact on me, and I fell in love with him instantly. He was kind of my gateway drug into Japanese wrestling. I really do credit Ultimo Dragon for being the wrestler that, when I discovered him at a young age, it really opened me up to the world of Japanese wrestling. I wanted to see more of his work. And then that's when I started really falling in love with Liger and a lot of the other junior heavyweights over there. And then falling in love with Japanese wrestling in general. And even Mexican wrestling. I started watching more AAA and CMLL. But I'm not going to talk about too much of that stuff. This is Ultimo Dragon. He's my favorite wrestler. I already have a TV title run up of him, but I'm going to focus more on his cruiserweight accomplishments. And he's also in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, and no doubt will I do a Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 Ultimo Dragon video and talk about his accomplishments over there in Japan. But let's get going. Let's talk about the Cruiserweight Championship. So, like my Eddie Guerrero video, like I talked about, the Cruiserweight Championship, you had to be a certain weight. It was under 220. Well, they changed it. It was around 220, 225. It always changed. So that limited a lot of guys eventually because they didn't really let a lot of the cruiserweights wrestle beyond their division. But a lot of people would argue that the cruiserweight division always had like the best matches. And I feel like some of the best matches you could find in the cruiserweight division are the matches with Ultimo Dragon. His first reign as Cruiserweight Champion is when he defeated D. Malenko at Starrcade 96. This was December 29th, 1996. That's why I chose the Starrcade background. Even though this Starrcade is modeled after Starrcade 97, I figured, you know, he won it at Starrcade. I might as well put it at Starrcade. He held the title only for 23 days and would lose the title back to D. Malenko at Clash of the Champions 34. Unfortunately, I don't have, I do fight D. Malenko later on. So that's going to be interesting when I fight D. Malenko later on in the video. I'm taking on Chris Jericho now, and Chris Jericho and Ultimo Dragon have a great match at Bash at the Beach 97. I have a Let's Play video of Bash at the Beach 97 where I go into a little bit more detail about that. So check out that video. But Ultimo Dragon's, after losing the title to D. Malenko at Clash of the Champions 34, he would go on and defeat Eddie Guerrero on an episode of Nitro at December 29th, 1997, so almost a year later, but he would only hold the Cruiserweight title for 10 days, and then he would lose the title to Juventud Guerrera on an episode of Thunder after beating Guerrero. So those were his title reigns. They were very short-lived. So why am I talking about Ultimo Dragon? Well, again, he won it in that year of the historical context. You know, the November of 97 is when we had World Tour drop, and we had Revenge drop in October of 98. So winning it in December of 97, beating Eddie Guerrero, who my first Cruiserweight Championship video was about. That's why I'm talking about Ultimo Dragon. But his first Cruiserweight title run was very significant because it was the first time American audiences got to see the J Crown Championship. Now, the J Crown Championship was actually a unification of 8 different junior heavyweight / cruiserweight titles from around the world, from 5 different promotions that, you know, ventured from Japan, Mexico, and America even. And the J Crown tournament was, when did it take place? It took place in August of 96. It actually took place during the G1 Climax tournament that year that New Japan was holding on. So they wanted to, make that event even more special. G1 Climax is their big yearly annual tournament. And I'm going to have some G1 Climax videos up either by the time this video comes out or during the time this video comes out. And the J Crown were, let's see, this is the first, these were the first J Crown belts. So it was the British Commonwealth Junior Heavyweight Championship from Michinoku Pro Wrestling, that was held by Jushin Thunder Liger. The IWGP Junior Heavyweight Championship from New Japan Pro Wrestling, that was held by Great Suzuki. The NWA World Junior Heavyweight Championship from Wrestle Dream Factory, and that was held by Masayoshi Motegi, or Motegi, I'm not sure if I'm saying that last name right, I apologize. NWA World Welterweight Championship, basically from CMLL, and that was held by Negro Casas. UWA World Junior Light Heavyweight Championship from the UWA, and that was held by Shinjiro Otani, who was the first Cruiserweight Champion, WCW Cruiserweight Champion. The War International Junior Heavyweight Championship, that was held by Ultimo Dragon. And Ultimo Dragon and Chris Jericho, and I talked about this in the Bash of the Beach 97, they had a match for this title at one point, and Chris Jericho says that was the match at one of War's big events that got him famous, or got him recognized, I should say, by the people from the Americas, and that led him to coming into ECW and WCW. So Ultimo Dragon and Chris Jericho have a lot of history. But Ultimo Dragon would be the one to defend the title at the New Japan Pro Wrestling J Crown tournament. And then you had the WWA World Junior Light Heavyweight Championship from the WWA World Wrestling Association, and that was held by Gran Hamada. And then the WWF Light Heavyweight Championship. Yes, the WWF Light Heavyweight Championship, and that was held by El Samurai. See, the Light Heavyweight Championship, when it was originally established, it didn't really spend a lot of time in WWF. And I talk about this in my Light Heavyweight Championship paths at No Mercy, that I do for No Mercy, where I talk about the history of the Light Heavyweight Championship. It was in Mexico, it was in a few other places, somewhere along the line it found way to New Japan. And El Samurai was a champion at one point, and they entered it in this tournament. And it's very important. Very important thing to keep track of. So basically, those were the competitors. Those were the titles to be put on the line. And the finals was actually Great Suzuki against Ultimo Dragon. And Great Suzuki won, and he became the first J Crown champion. He didn't hold it for long. He would lose the title after about 67 days to Ultimo Dragon at an event in New Japan. And Ultimo Dragon started appearing on WCW TV and pay-per-views with the J Crown Championship. So when he fought Dean Malenko, he was the J Crown Champion at that time. And it was a double title match. Ultimo Dragon had his J Crown title on the line, and Dean Malenko had his Cruiserweight title on the line. And whoever would win would get both titles, or all 9 belts. So this was the first time and only time that, well, not necessarily, because if you count when Medusa showed up and she dropped the women's title in the trash on Nitro, but the WWF Light Heavyweight Championship actually was defended in some shape or form on WCW. It's kind of nuts if you think about it. And WWF didn't know about this. And when they found out about this, when they found out when the J Crown was using the WWF Light Heavyweight title, they wanted it back, and that's when the J Crown Championship kind of disbanded, really, when Shinjiro Otani was the champion by that point. And he had to return the light heavyweight title along, and he returned all the other titles as well. I guess maybe they didn't want to run into any more issues with having to return titles, and then eventually there'd be no more J Crown left. So, but that was, I feel like that's what a lot of people remember Ultimo Dragon, him coming out with all the belts. I mean, he only held the J Crown for a little bit, because even though he beat Great Suzuki on October 11th, 96, he would lose the J Crown to Jushin Thunder Liger at the New Japan Tokyo Dome show on January 4th, 1997. So he only held it about three months? But still, he showed up quite a bit on WCW. There was an episode of Nitro where he shows up on it. He actually defends the J Crown Championship against Rey Mysterio Jr. at World War III 96. So if you want to see Ultimo Dragon against Rey Mysterio Jr. For the J Crown Championship, you can watch that on the WWE Network at World War III 96. But the Dean Malenko Ultimo Dragon match, oh my goodness, so good. So good. Watch that match for the Cruiserweight title. This wasn't the first time that Ultimo Dragon and Dean Malenko met for the Cruiserweight Championship. Ultimo Dragon was kind of chasing the Cruiserweight Championship from Dean Malenko, and he finally was able to defeat him. Ultimo Dragon was riding high during this period. Also during this time when he won the J Crown Championship and he won the Cruiserweight Championship, Ultimo Dragon was actually the holder of the NWA World Middleweight Championship. He was actually holding that title for a few years. He bought the rights to the title actually so he could defend it outside of Mexico, but also when he would return to Mexico, because he still wrestled in Mexico a lot, and he was actually wrestling in Mexico quite a bit when he was wrestling for WCW. He would defend his NWA World Middleweight Championship over there. So Ultimo Dragon at one point held 10 titles simultaneously, a record that still stands today. No other wrestler has ever held 10 titles at one time, and Ultimo Dragon has that honor. It was always cool to see him coming out holding a bunch of the belts, and Sonny Ono coming out holding a bunch of the belts. Here we go, I'm taking on Eddie Guerrero. So I'm going for the Mexican surfboard. I should point this out. I've done this a few times, but I'm going to point it out. If you notice, my meter was going up. Ultimo Dragon is one of the few people who have a submission move in this game where your meter goes up. Now, that normally isn't supposed to happen, but for some reason it happens in Revenge, specifically for certain submission moves, and the Mexican surfboard being one of them. Another move is the Lion Tamer. Chris Jericho's Lion Tamer's meters go up. They fixed this in WrestleMania 2000 and WWF No Mercy. That doesn't happen. The only time your meter will go up if you're doing a submission move in those games is if you have a comeback special. And that also happens in this game. If you get a comeback special, all your submission moves, the meter goes up. But specifically for the Mexican Surfboard and the Lion Tamer, your meter will go up too. So that's kind of a neat bonus. I talked about in the beginning of the video that Ultimo Dragon is one of my favorite wrestlers to play as in this game. Not only because he's one of my favorite wrestlers, but because his moveset is great. It's very powerful. He's got great striking moves, great strong striking moves. His grapple moves are very diverse. He's got the Mexican surfboard submission, which is great for setting up the Dragon Sleeper if you want to finish the Dragon Sleeper. But you also raise your meter by doing the Mexican surfboard. He's got the running Liger Bomb as his front special. He's got the Dragon Kanrana. He's got so many great moves. I love playing with him. He's very dynamic, very diverse. The only thing I'm not crazy about is that he has the grapple striking combination going on. I'm not a big fan of that, especially in this game when you're playing on hard, because it's very easy for the computer to counter it, and there's not really much benefit of using it, because when you're using it, even though if you connect on your striking hits, your meter goes up, but the computer's meter goes up as well, because in this game striking brings up both people's meter, which is weird. They fixed that in WrestleMania 2000. But yeah, I'm fighting Eddie Guerrero, and Eddie Guerrero and Ultimo Dragon too. Like, Ultimo Dragon was trained in Mexico, and not trained in Mexico, he was trained in Japan, but he made his mark in Mexico. So he adapted the Lucha Libre style in Mexico, probably fought a bunch of the Guerreros along with Eddie Guerrero. And I'm wearing one of my favorite outfits that Ultimo Dragon ever wore, and that's this red, white, and green outfit, and it's great because it's representing the Mexican flag, and it kind of represents Ultimo Dragon's duality as a wrestler. Have him wearing this Japanese inspired outfit with the mask and everything, but Lucha Libre also has the history with the mask, and he's a Japanese wrestler, but he's very much a homegrown Mexican wrestler as well in a way. And I love this outfit. He comes out, he has the cape, and the cape has the flag on it. It's a fantastic outfit. He wore this outfit at Great American Bash 97 when he took on Psychosis, and that was, I think it was at Great American Bash 97. I could be wrong about that. It might have been at Uncensored 97. It was Great American Bash 97. Yeah, it was Great American Bash 97 where he fought Psychosis. And I loved it. I fought Psychosis in the beginning of the episode, and I wanted to talk about Ultimo Dragon's Cruiserweight stuff first, but if you watch Uncensored 97 when he fights Psychosis, it's an okay match, it's a good match, but they fight again at Great American Bash 97, and this was the time where Ultimo Dragon was breaking away from Sonny Ono. Sonny Ono was in Psychosis's corner, so people finally got to cheer for Ultimo Dragon. And a couple of months before this, he fought Rey Mysterio Jr. at Spring Stampede, And he also came out without Ultimo Dragon, without Sonny Ono. And he was kind of having a riff at the time with Sonny Ono, you know, on camera. It was all storyline. And I think it was that match, after with the Rey Mysterio match, that really fans were like, it's okay for cheer for this guy now. Because they were always booing him because, you know, in wrestling, if you're Japanese, you're automatically a bad guy. At least that's how it used to be. And, you know, the same thing was said about Ultimate Dragon, you know, and Sonny Ono was his heel manager. And basically, they were heel because they were Japanese, you know, like, that's pretty much it. Like, boo them because they're Japanese and cheer Dean Malenko because he's not Japanese. And, you know, it's there I go. I beat Agro with the running Liger Bomb. It's hard to pull off the running Liger Bomb in this game because you can't, when you strong grapple, you can't walk with the opponent like you can in the other games in WrestleMania 2000 and No Mercy. So you have to make sure that when you go for this move, you're in good positioning already. And I saw there I was in good positioning, so I was like, you know what, let me go for the Liger Bomb, the running Liger Bomb. And I did it. It was great. Here comes Chris Benoit. Unfortunately, I couldn't find any Chris Benoit Ultimo Dragon matches on the WWE Network. I'm sure they met at one point. You would have to imagine they would have met at one point. They definitely met in Japan when Chris Benoit wrestled as the Pegasus Kid. They wrestled, in various events. I don't know the specifics, but I'll probably talk about that when I do my Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 episodes about, you know, like the J Crown tournaments and the Super Junior tournaments. But yeah, that match with Psychosis, Great American Bash, where he wears his outfit, great match, love it. Fans are losing their mind for Ultimo Dragon. And that's one of the things I loved about Ultimo Dragon is that he had such a personality behind that mask. You really felt like you knew who he was when he came out. You know, he separated himself from Psychosis and Juventud Guerrera and Rey Mysterio Jr. Like, you know, a lot of the Lucha Libre, mask wrestlers, I felt like, with the exception, obviously, of like maybe Rey Mysterio Jr. and Juventud and La Parka, you know, their personality wasn't quite exact. Like, even Psychosis, you know, looking back at Psychosis, and even growing up when I used to watch Psychosis, I never really felt like I knew who this guy was. You know what I mean? I got a good idea who Rey Mysterio was, who La Parka was, and even Juventud. But, Ultimo Dragon definitely let his personality shine. I guess that's why I always gravitated towards him, even when he was supposed to be a bad guy. But he never did anything like that. He was never like a heel in the ring. He didn't take dirty shots. He didn't take cheap shots. It was Sonny Ono would take the shots sometimes. Sometimes he would take liberties with the guy when they would fall out the ring or whatever. But never Ultimo Dragon. Ultimo Dragon was just gonna, you know, he was very cocky. If anything, that was the one thing about Ultimo Dragon. He was very much, you know, especially that first match with Rey Mysterio Jr. when he debuted, he's toying around with him. He's like lifting him up after the two count, you know, not putting him away. And that's his downfall in a lot of the matches, is that he'll lose because he lets his arrogance get in the way of beating these wrestlers. But I love that. I love that about him. Like, this was a guy who was so, so charismatic, even within the mask, and even more so than Rey Mysterio Jr. I think the appeal to me for Rey Mysterio Jr. was that he was doing moves no one else could do. I mean, the guy was nuts, the stuff he was doing. And you could see that in a lot of the matches, even between him and Ultimo Dragon. But everywhere else, you know, I talked about in Eddie Guerrero's Cruiserweight run, Rey Mysterio's matches with Eddie Guerrero, and the stuff he was pulling out was nuts. And I think that's why everyone gravitated towards Rey Mysterio Jr., because he was just crazy with the stuff he was doing. It was so good, so fluid, so smooth. No one was doing the stuff he was doing, not even any of the other cruiserweights or Lucha Libre wrestlers or anything like that. But Ultimo Dragon had a personality. He had a swagger to him, you know, that I really liked. And Rey Mysterio didn't have that swagger. He just came in, he did some great moves, and that was it. You know, he was very much the babyface, you know, trying his hardest. It was good. It was great to watch him. Ultimo Dragon had this swagger where he would go in and always play to the crowd. It almost seemed like after every move, he would play to the crowd. So yeah, that's why I love Ultimo Dragon. But what else can we talk about? So Ultimo Dragon's Cruiserweight run was short-lived. But yeah, let's go back to the J Crown. So He beat Dean Malenko, and he got the Cruiserweight title, and he also had the J Crown title. Now, he would defend his Cruiserweight title the next night on Nitro. And you can watch this. And there I beat Chris Benoit with the Mexican surfboard. I didn't think I was going to beat him with the Mexican surfboard, but I guess he couldn't make it to the ropes at the time. So whatever, I don't get to, you know, beat him with the Dragon Sleeper or anything like that. That happens. Sometimes I'll put submissions on guys and then I won't realize, oh, I'm beating them. Or when I pin a guy and I don't realize, like, hey, maybe they're not going to kick out. Sometimes I'll try to break it, you know, because I don't want to end a match a certain way. But in this case, I can't. Here comes the Parka, chairman of the board, the chairman of WCW. This is so funny because he comes out and he's like playing the chair guitar, but he doesn't have the chair with him. But then when the match starts, he's gonna have the chair. I think that's hilarious. You know, I don't know how they programmed it, but for some reason, you know, it would have been great to see him holding the chair in his hand. In No Mercy, you can, in WrestleMania 2000, I believe also, you can come in with the items and walk to the ring with the items. So you can definitely recreate La Parka's taunts. Unfortunately, they don't have the create a mask feature that Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 has. So you could fully recreate La Parka, even though, but you really can't recreate La Parka or Ultimo Dragon in that matter. Well, Ultimo Dragon's in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, but in Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, you have a create a mask feature where you can give masks to the wrestlers, and they took that out in No Mercy for whatever reason, which sucks because, like, right after No Mercy, Rey Mysterio debuts in WWF, so it would have been great to be able to create Rey Mysterio. I don't know why they took out the mask. Maybe they didn't feel like any need for it because there weren't a lot of mask wrestlers, but you gotta wonder. I mean, the people who make these games, I really wish I could, like, one day interview some of them, because even with today's modern games, you gotta wonder, their audience, yeah, is the fan of wrestling, and you know, they want to get those wrestling fans to buy the wrestling games. But I feel like with the wrestling games, this is like the really dedicated wrestling fans' opportunity to live out, like, their fantasies, their dreams. And maybe, you know, you can't insert a few wrestlers because of copyright, or they're not with the company or whatever, yada yada yada. But maybe in the created wrestler, at least put the options to create everyone, like, pretty much perfectly. Like, you gotta think, aren't these games being developed by wrestling fans, or at least fans of a wrestling video game, so they know in their mind, maybe I should put this outfit in and not say specifically who it's for, but all the wrestling fans will know, oh, this outfit belongs to La Parka or something like that. I don't know. I feel like they wouldn't get in trouble in that case, because if you look at when the creator wrestler option was featured in WrestleMania 2000, they had a bunch of outfits in there that, you know, they didn't have the wrestlers in there, but they had the outfits. Like, they had the LOD face paint. You know, they had both Animal and Hawk's face paint. And then it's weird because in No Mercy, they only have, I think they only have Animal's face paint, and they don't have Hawk's, or vice versa. You know, but, like, I feel like they could have included all the masks that they included from Virtual Pro Wrestling 2 in No Mercy. And, you know, if people create them in the game, that's no big deal. That's not WWF's fault that people created in the game. They're just putting it in there and put it in there and, like, just, you know, generic, just hide it. Just don't really basically, you know, don't name it. This is Jushin Thunder Liger's mask, or this is Ultimo Dragon's mask. I don't know. I don't know why the reason what it is. It, you know, with WWE 2K15, you know, they kind of have those limitations too. You would think with a game like that, they would have an infinite amount of possibilities you can create with the wrestlers, and it's really good. It's really good. Don't get me wrong. It's really good. But when it comes to certain outfits and attires, they're kind of lacking. Like, I was looking at it and I was trying to make old Rey Mysterio Jr. I was trying to make old Rey Mysterio Jr. in WWE 2K15, and they don't really quite have an outfit that looks like his old tights. Same thing with Ultimo Dragon. You can kind of make his mask and you can kind of make his pants pretty well, but they don't have his chest plate. And it's like, come on, just put his chest plate in there. Everyone will know that's Ultimo Dragon's chest plate. So you could just, you know, people will go ahead and make them. Like, I feel like you're doing the benefit for the fan. If you have everything but the chest plate, you're going to have a very incomplete Ultimo Dragon. And the Ultimo Dragon creations in WWE 2K15 are kind of lacking because of that. Here I give La Parka the Dragon Kunrana loved when Ultimo Dragon would do it. But see here, right here, when I go for the running Liger Bomb, I wasn't in great positioning. I basically did it because I didn't want to waste my special. Might as well pull off a move. Usually the computer will stay down after the Dragon Kunrana, so I can go right into a Dragon Sleeper, and the positioning is like perfect in that case for the Dragon Sleeper, and then usually that picks up a victory for me. Another reason why I love playing as Ultimo Dragon. They even have his taunt where he balances on the turnbuckle, man. Ultimo Dragon's just great in this game. La Parka, not so much. The thing about La Parka, he was very cool too, very charismatic, had a great look. Very underused in WCW. Superstar in Mexico. Because he has a great personality, and he has a great look, and he knows how to, he's a good worker in the ring. But the thing with La Parka is like one of the two cruiserweights in this game that never held the cruiserweight title. The only other one being Lodi. Every other person you could wrestle as in the cruiserweight division in this game held the cruiserweight championship at one point, which is kind of neat. But yeah, so let's get back. What were we talking about? Oh yeah, before I got distracted with the gameplay and talking about other Ultimo Dragon related things. So he fought for D. Malenko, Starrcade, won the title. The next night he takes on Jushin Thunder Liger on an episode of Raw, and he defends the Cruiserweight Championship. And you can actually watch this. No, you can't watch this on the network. I'm sorry. I wish you could watch it on the network. But he would beat Jushin Thunder Liger. And that's very important because this is December 30th, 1997. And just less than a week later, they would go to Japan. And at the New Japan Tokyo Dome show, Liger and Ultimo Dragon would face for the J Crown. And Jushin Thunder Liger would beat Ultimo Dragon for the J Crown. So even though Liger doesn't get the Cruiserweight Championship, Liger gets the J Crown Championship. I just recently subscribed to New Japan Pro Wrestling, or New Japan World, I should say. I've been putting it off for months. I don't know why. All I had to do was just sign up. But I do that sometimes. Like uploading videos on my YouTube. Sometimes I take a bit. But they don't, unfortunately, have a lot of those classic matches that I'm looking for. Like, I'm looking for a lot of the Liger Ultimo Dragon stuff, and it would have been neat to see that match, because I don't know if I've actually seen that match, that New Japan J Crown Championship match between Liger and Ultimo Dragon. I would have to rewatch it to say that, oh yeah, I remember seeing it. Because even when I was doing research for the Ultimo Dragon episode, and I was looking at all the matches you could find on the network, I was remembering some of them. But I don't know if you have this thing too, where you've watched wrestling for so many years, and people's matches, unless they like really stand out, unless they were really memorable, they all kind of blend to like one match. So like, all of Rey Mysterio and Ultimo Dragon's matches sort of blended to one in my mind, and I couldn't really remember specifically, you know, what was done, you know, when and where. But when I had to rewatch the match, I was like, oh, this was the match when they did that. This was the match when Ultimo Dragon gave Rey Mysterio the running Liger Bomb, and it looked like he killed them, like, you know. And speaking of Rey Mysterio Jr., I wanted to wait till Rey Mysterio came out, because Ultimo Dragon and Rey Mysterio Jr., they have a bunch of matches that you can find on the network. Okay, you got the Hog Wild match where Ultimo Dragon appeared, and that was pretty good. That was Hog Wild 96, and then they got a bunch of matches that you can find. They have a few Nitro matches. There was one time they fought on Nitro, August 1996. Then they fight at World War III, 96, when Ultimo Dragon puts up his J Crown. But I think if you watch any Rey Mysterio Jr. Ultimo Dragon match that's on the WWE Network, go watch Rey Mysterio Jr. Ultimo Dragon Spring Stampede 1997. It was on April 6th. And no title, no J Crown, no Cruiserweight. Ultimo Dragon would win his second Cruiserweight title months later, towards the end of the year. Rey Mysterio Jr. doesn't have the Cruiserweight title at this point. He's chasing it, trying to get it back. But Ultimo Dragon and Rey Mysterio meet, and this is, I think, the best match on the network between Ultimo Dragon and Rey Mysterio Jr. Fantastic match. This is technically the rubber match, if you will, for their pay-per-view meetings. They did have that Nitro match between the two of them. fantastic match. I can't talk about it. I can't say any more positive things about it. It's fantastic. It's great. It's exhilarating. The crowd is super into it. And I think this was the point where the crowd was like, we don't want to boo Ultimo Dragon anymore. He's not really a bad guy. When he comes out, he does great stuff. His matches with Dean Malenko are fantastic. Every time he fights Dean Malenko, we're losing our minds. So why should we boo him? And I think him not coming out with Sonny Ono helped. And maybe that's what they were trying to gauge. They were trying to gauge, can this guy make it on his own without Sonny Ono? And can he be a face? And he was already a popular wrestler in Japan, so why not, you know? But him and Rey Mysterio, they tear the house down. Fantastic match. I'm not going to spoil it. I'm not going to say who wins because I want you to go watch it. I mean, you could probably just Google it, but to see who wins. Great match. Great match. Can't say enough about it. You know, it's the moves they do. You know, this is almost a year since Ultimo Dragon's debut in WCW. They worked with each other enough times. Ultimo Dragon has really gotten comfortable on the camera. I mean, he was already Cruiserweight champion by this point, but I feel like they were in a groove where they really knew each other well. They really knew how to work the audience well. And I really wish, you know, we had a Cruiserweight division these days in WWE. You know, I talk about this a lot. I talked about this a lot during my light heavyweight championship run when I did my No Mercy videos. I even talked about this at length during my Ultimo Dragon TV title run, even though I should have been talking more about his TV title accomplishments. But yeah, I think a Cruiserweight division could still hold up in this day and age. I mean, the only problem I see now is that you definitely don't want to pigeonhole a lot of the younger guys, because you look at guys like Neville, you look at guys like, you know, that are coming up, and they are on the smaller side, and you don't want to say, oh, you can only stay in the Cruiserweight division. So if you do make a title that's, you know, around the Cruiserweight division, I guess you would have to do what TNA does. And TNA, they have the X division title. So they didn't want to call it a Cruiserweight or a Junior Heavyweight, because, you know, they still wanted guys like Samoa Joe to wrestle for it. They didn't want to just pigeonhole a guy because of their size. They wanted to make a title that, you know, showed off that lightweight flying style. But that doesn't necessarily mean you have to be, you know, 5'7", 215 to wrestle. And Samoa Joe works perfectly with guys of that size. I mean, Samoa Joe himself is not a tall guy, but he fits perfectly in that division, and he also fits perfectly in the heavyweight division. So, yeah, I mean, I would love to see a, you know, quote-unquote Cruiserweight division, but at least call it something else so you don't put, you know, the mentality that, oh, these are just the small guys, and they're wrestling for the small man's title. And I think that's what held a lot of these guys back in WCW, is because the booking committee or the guys in charge or whatever, they definitely saw them as those small guys. They saw Jericho and Dean Malenko and Ultimo Dragon and Rey Mysterio as the small guys fighting for the Cruiserweight Championship. Dean Malenko was so over in 1996 and 1997. When I was going back and watching the Ultimo Dragon Dean Malenko videos, and I'm facing Dean Malenko now, Dean Malenko was so over. He did nothing but wrestle. And I think that was the great thing about Dean Malenko. Like, the dude just came out, busted his ass, and you loved him. Like, the reactions he would get, the crowd was, I can't wait till I do my Dean Malenko Cruiserweight title run, because he was one of the, you know, longest reigning Cruiserweight champions. He held the title second most, tied with Chris Jericho in WCW. You know, he held the Cruiserweight title four times, and I feel like all his title defenses and Cruiserweight matches were five-star matches, pretty much. I mean, his match with Ultimo Dragon at Starrcade is great, but really, the Dean Malenko Ultimo Dragon Championship match at Clash of the Champions 34, go watch that one on the network. That one is fantastic. The Starrcade match is great, but I prefer the Clash of the Champions 34 match. That was 97, January of 97. So they have all of the Clash of the Champions on the WWE Network. So you can watch Ultimo Dragon and Dean Malenko go at it. And he was just fantastic, man. And he was another one that could wrestle with the big guys, but they just never let him. You know, unfortunately, when he came to WWE, he was more of at the twilight of his career than all the other radicals, you know, like Benoit, Eddie Guerrero, and Saturn. So he wasn't utilized enough, but he was the most dominant light heavyweight champion in WWF. So, it's saying something. Even though the WWF light heavyweight division probably wasn't as stacked at that time as the cruiserweight division was in WCW. But even when they finally started getting guys to fill up that cruiserweight division, WWF never really did anything with it. And Ultimo Dragon even came to the WWF at one point. But his time in WWE was very short-lived. They definitely didn't use him enough. And they could have done so much with that because he was a legend in Japan, a legend in Mexico. And the reason why he left WCW so early, like I said, he debuted in Hog Wild of 96. But he would leave in 1998. In late 1998, Ultimo Dragon would leave the WCW because he essentially retired. He retired because he had an arm injury. And he went to get a surgery, and they botched the surgery, so he thought he could never wrestle again. I think it was a multiple surgeries too. He kept going back trying to get his arms fixed, and for whatever reason, I think there was something with the nerves or whatever, and he just wasn't having any feeling in his arms, this and that, so he couldn't wrestle. So he had to retire. He had to retire at a very young age. He was 30 when he first came to the WCW, so he was probably about 32, 33 when this was happening. He went back to Japan. That's when he started his own wrestling school, the Dragon Wrestling School, and then he eventually founded his own promotion, Torayuman. And a lot of guys came out of Torayuman. You had Shima, Nobunaga, you had Magnum Tokyo, who appeared briefly in WCW. Actually, Ultimo Dragon's last match in WCW was against Tokyo Magnum, who was his student. At the time, it was on an episode of Nitro, July 20th of 1998, and Tokyo Magnum and Ultimo Dragon fought, and that was one of Ultimo Dragon's top students at the time, coming out of Torayuman. So he bounced around and he trained a bunch of other guys, and the Torayuman promotion was kind of getting noticed and making a name for itself, and eventually that would become the Dragon Gate promotion. And Ultimo Dragon eventually left the promotion after a while and resumed wrestling, and that was kind of a miracle story in itself. And Ultimo Dragon is still wrestling today, and he's actually I don't know if he's still the All Asia Tag Team Champion. I could be wrong. I mean, he might have lost it by now, but he holds a tag team title in All Japan Pro Wrestling. And that when he came to the WWE, that could have been a big thing. They could have played that up. They could have played the history of him and Rey Mysterio Jr. They could have played the history of Ultimo Dragon coming back, fighting from injury, and being this legendary, mystical Japanese wrestler. And they did nothing with it, because basically they were doing nothing with the cruiserweights at all at that time. And it's very unfortunate. You go back, you watch any of these cruiserweight matches with Ultimo Dragon, and they're all good. There's not like a one match where I watched. I mean, maybe the Psychosis Uncensored match was kind of like a dud. It wasn't as great as all, but all the matches were all matches they can really get behind. So it's a shame. One of the former writers of WWF, forgot his name, but he wrote a book about his time in WWF, and he was a huge fan of Lucha Libre and Mexican wrestling. And the mask wrestler, and he wanted to bring in Ultimo Dragon when he was at WWF. And this was the time when Ultimo Dragon came in, and he was trying really hard to rebuild the cruiserweight division around Ultimo Dragon. Because Ultimo Dragon was the veteran, and he could definitely help make a lot of the new up and coming cruiserweights that they could bring in, and he could also be a great transition between bringing in Mexican wrestlers and Japanese wrestlers along with American wrestlers, because he could do all that. Ultimo Dragon could wrestle every style. He could wrestle the American style, Japanese style, and Mexican style. He could wrestle everything, and probably even European style, because Ultimo Dragon's matches with William Regal are great when they were feuding over the TV title. So Ultimo Dragon could do it all. He really wanted to build a division over him, and he talks about how Vince McMahon just didn't get it. He just didn't get the appeal. He was like, "We already have Rey Mysterio Jr. Why do we need another mask wrestler?" that's basically what he said. And the writer was like, "Are you kidding me? in Mexico, there's hundreds of wrestlers with masks, and people can tell them apart. People know who they are. People know who all their stories are. They get it, and then Vince McMahon just didn't get it. He just didn't see the appeal. He didn't see the appeal of having more than one masked wrestler, which is why I'm surprised today. I mean, maybe he's lightened up today because now you got Kalisto and Sin Cara running around, who's actually, I believe that's Unico or Epico. I always confuse the two, which is bad. I shouldn't confuse the two because I'm Latin. Here I am confusing Latin wrestlers, but you know, it's just mind-boggling that he has that mentality, because the mask is such an important thing in Mexico, and you know, people tell them apart. I think he discredits his audience, and I think a lot of people do this. A lot of people discredit the WWE audience. I don't discredit the WWE audience. You know, I don't like to discriminate against people and what they watch. Hey, I watch wrestling. I watch all types of wrestling, but I don't look at the different audiences and say, oh, one is better than the other. I don't say, oh, the Ring of Honor audience is more, you know, educated or better than the WWE audience, or the Lucha Underground audience is not as educated as the New Japan audience. I don't say that. I mean, we're all in this together. I mean, we all watch wrestling. We shouldn't fight amongst ourselves because we got enough people bad-mouthing us for watching wrestling anyway. So why fight amongst ourselves? But I think to make a comment like that, to say that the audiences wouldn't get it, you're discrediting your audience. I mean, look how many masked wrestlers were running around in WCW. And everyone that I talked to that remembers on these Cruiserweight matches fondly, they knew who Juventud Guerrera was, and they knew he was different from Rey Mysterio. They knew that he was different from Ultimo Dragon and La Parka and Psychosis and even the Villanos. Even Villanos, and who else did you have briefly in there? Who else wore a mask? Lizmark Jr. wore a mask. Ah, looking about it, maybe they didn't have too many mask wrestlers. Huh, that's interesting. I gotta look back to see how many mask wrestlers actually came through WCW, because that'd be an interesting thing too. Oh, well, you had Liger, obviously. You had Liger there for a little bit. But, you know, people were able to tell them apart. You know, now, Sin Cara and Kalisto, people know the difference between Sin Cara and Kalisto. I mean, masks are great. I always wanted a mask growing up as a kid. That's like great merchandising. You can really get people behind these wrestlers, but also to like tell the story behind the mask. And I think that was the appeal of Rey Mysterio and why Rey Mysterio was so huge, because when they started telling the story behind the mask and started letting him be himself, yeah, you couldn't see his face, but you still knew who this guy was. And not saying every mask wrestler needs to have that mystique, you know, where you have to know who the guy under the mask is. Sometimes it works better when you don't know who the guy under the mask is, and it creates more of a mystery. But yeah, you know, like Kalisto has a very interesting story, very similar. He's American raised, you know, he's got Mexican nationality, but he's from Chicago, made his mark in the indie scene in Florida. I mean, you know, the dude's wrestling a great fast style of like, it's more so indie wrestling, but he does try to blend in the Lucha Libre style of wrestling. I mean, he would be a great wrestler that I hope they build up, because he's got such great talent and capability. You know, you look at TNA wrestling, where they got Tigre Uno wrestling there, and you know, he's fantastic too, young upstart. Yeah, I mean, not really, you know, upstart. He's been wrestling in Mexico for years, but I feel like there's still a market for mask wrestlers in American wrestling. They just don't push them the right way. And that's why I felt about Ultimo Dragon's run in WWE. Here comes Chavo Guerrero. I'm facing Chavo Guerrero for the Cruiserweight Championship. Now, actually, so I haven't really talked about this yet, but unfortunately, during the time from, you know, October of 97 to October of 98, you know, this is the historical context part. Let's get back to it a little bit. When this game was being developed, Ultimo Dragon didn't make a lot of appearances on pay-per-view. So he was on Halloween Havoc 97, where he faced Yuji Nagata. And Yuji Nagata was new to wrestling at this point. He had just graduated from the New Japan Dojo. And they sent him over to the Americas to sort of like, you know, cut his teeth a little bit. Yuji Nagata would become a huge star in Japan. Especially with New Japan Pro Wrestling. And he's still wrestling today. He's going to be in the G1 2015 Climax. But he faces Ultimo Dragon, faces Yuji Nagata, who's now being backed by Sonny Ono. And Yuji Nagata, the sort of angle was that Yuji Nagata was the hitman to take care of Ultimo Dragon because Sonny Ono was mad that Ultimo Dragon has refused his services. So Halloween Havoc 97, Yuji Nagata beats Ultimo Dragon. And then they meet again at World War 3 97, and Yuji Nagata beats him again. So then the next pay-per-view, Starrcade 97. Ultimo Dragon doesn't wrestle at Starrcade 97, but the next night, that's when he beats Eddie Guerrero for his second Cruiserweight title run, but loses it like in 10 days to Juventud Guerrera. And then no pay-per-view appearances. He's still wrestling on Nitro and Thunder. He's wrestling quite a bit on Nitro and Thunder, but he doesn't make another pay-per-view appearance until Spring Stampede 98. Where he fights Chavo Guerrero. And I talked about this a little bit in my Eddie Guerrero Cruiserweight run. Chavo Guerrero was fighting for his freedom. He was fighting for his freedom from Eddie Guerrero, who was basically giving him tough love. And Chavo Guerrero, if he beat Ultimo Dragon, then he could kind of like free himself. But if Ultimo Dragon won, then Eddie Guerrero would be that much harder on him. So he lost, and then at Slamboree 98, Eddie Guerrero takes on Ultimo Dragon with sort of the same stipulation, but Eddie Guerrero beats Ultimo Dragon, and Chavo Guerrero actually turns on Ultimo Dragon at the end of the match because he's so frustrated, and he kind of like accepts his place being Eddie Guerrero's lackey. But then they would have a blow-off match between them, but that's it. You wouldn't see Ultimo Dragon anymore on pay-per-view after that, and that's because he started battling the injuries. So, unfortunately, even though Ultimo Dragon won his second Cruiserweight title during this time, there's not a whole lot of talk about during the development time, you know, from World Tour to No Mercy. But Ultimo Dragon was in Virtual Pro 64, World Tour, Revenge, and Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. So Ultimo Dragon was in four of the AKI developed wrestling games. He wasn't with WWF at the time. So he couldn't be in WrestleMania 2000 or No Mercy. And unfortunately, since you can't do Creative Mask, you couldn't create him in those games. So he almost made it. Still, four out of the six games, that's pretty good. Definitely more than Chavo Guerrero ever was in. So here I go. I gave him the Hurricanrana. Going for the Dragon Sleeper. Is this going to put him away? That's perfect positioning right there, as you've probably noticed from when I've been doing the Dragon Sleeper. And there he go, he gives up. So that's my Ultimo Dragon Cruiserweight Championship run. I hope you loved it as much as I have. I love talking about this guy. I could talk about this guy for years. Okay, don't be surprised if down the line I just start doing a bunch of Ultimo Dragon WCW NW Revenge videos after I do all the championship runs, because I just love this guy. I love Ultimo Dragon so much, but watch his WWE Network stuff, you know, with his WCW matches against Rey Mysterio Jr. and Dean Malenko. Fantastic stuff. If you've never seen his work before, you know, in WCW, now's the time to do it with the network. It's never too late to be a fan of this guy. But yeah, I hope you liked it. I hope you liked this match. Coming up after this, who do I have coming up for the Cruiserweight Championship? It would be Hoovy. It would be Juventud Guerrero, because Juventud Guerrero beat Ultimo Dragon for the Cruiserweight title. So Juventud Guerrero would be next in line for my Cruiserweight Championship run. But I hope you liked it. And keep watching wrestling, and I'll see you next time. Peace.